So hey guys, it's Artcast number 345, I'm pretty sure. Let me set this down. I don't like to look at myself on the screen. I found a little device. I don't know what it's called. It's like this thing you stick between your camera and your computer, and so that you can actually film HD. So you can like basically film on your DSLR. It runs through this little device. And you know, you capture like HD footage to your computer instead of like your card. And so what's really cool about that is I could just sit here and film like my Artcast with my nicer camera instead of my webcam, and just have it go right on my computer. Because I mean I have it set up so, you know, I have my camera plugged in to the wall so it doesn't turn off, but it runs out of space on the card. So I got like about 17 minutes to go, like, that I can record an Artcast with or whatever I'm recording, and it works fine for like the speed paints and stuff because they're just kind of like small clips. But then when I'm trying to record like this specific kind of show where it's just like me talking and drawing, and I kind of have been feeling like I want to do more of those, you know. It's kind of a pain because I feel like this timer start when I start up, and it's like a deadline suddenly, and I got to get to the point and blah blah blah. And you know, these shows, I don't have a point most of the time, you know, it's just me talking. And I think that's kind of what makes them kind of good, and also why I like to do them, you know, because I'm not sort of selling anything, I'm just sort of just putting it out there. Putting out my feelings or whatever you want to, you know what I mean? I'm just talking to you guys like as if, you know, like, I don't know, like we work together or something, and we're sitting around doing our work and we're just chatting, you know. So I want to get this thing anyway. That was our point, is I want to get this thing. I can't remember what it's called. It's like I don't remember, but it's like an HDMI to, I think what it does is it kind of like, it basically keeps it so there's no loss in the quality. So then I could have like the nice quality of my camera, and not have to, you know, not have the pressure of a timer or something. And I could just kind of, you know, talk, and then, you know, cut out the parts I don't like. Much like I do with my webcam. When I looked it up on eBay and also Amazon. On Amazon they're almost $300, but I noticed you can find them on eBay for about $160 or something like that. They're quite a bit cheaper, but both those things are a little out of my price range right now, so gonna have to wait and bide my time till I get a little extra cash. So probably after Christmas sometime I'll have some, and I'll go for that and up the quality a little bit. I got some emails this week from different artists that watch my show, and I think it's just because I started kind of doing the Artcast again, and you know, kind of talking off the cuff to the camera, that people sort of responded to that. And I think it's cool because it's like it makes me sort of remember like why I started doing the show in the first place, you know, like back when I quit my job, and you know, I didn't have anybody to sort of bounce this off of. My wife was sort of against the idea, and I was in my room, you know, in my little studio here, drawing like hell, trying to sort of, you know, stay ahead of the, you know, the bills, like the waves, you know, coming in with the bills. And I didn't have anybody on my side, you know. Not that my wife's not on my side, but it's just, you know, it's a scary thing for her to have to deal with me doing this kind of stuff. and all my crazy ideas and stuff. And you know, she's awesome to kind of follow me down like all these rabbit holes. But yeah, I didn't have anybody to sort of, I felt like talking and I didn't have anybody to talk to, so I just talked to the internet. And you know, weirdly enough, there was people out there that wanted to listen to me and talk back, you know. It's like I've made a lot of friends and stuff like that because of like what I did, you know. But anyway, I got some emails again, and I'm sure it's because I started doing, you know, I just started talking to the camera in a real way again, you know. And they just were guys, you know, different artists, like talking about like their business and where they're at and what's going on. And some of them wanted sort of maybe advice, but then, you know, a lot of them, I think they were just, you know, just letting me know what's up, you know, what's going on with them. And there's like three of them that were just sort of three different people actually, and actually four if you count my other friend who I've just been kind of talking to here and there lately. But he's dealing with the same thing where it's, you're kind of like dealing with like, you know, you tried it and it's not working, you know what I mean? And so it's sort of like kind of like failure. And you know, it's like, man, it's rough, you know, it sucks. And the thing about it is like, I've been there, you know, I've so been there. It's like, the last time I left my job was probably like, I want to say like it could have been the sixth time, but it was actually probably the fifth time I tried. It's probably actually more than that if you really went back. But yeah, it was probably like the fifth time I tried to make a living at this, you know. And every time before that, you know, I don't know if I failed or whatever, but some way I ended up back, you know, at a day job or something like that, you know. And why I say I don't know if I failed, because, you know, sometimes there was extenuating circumstances. And this last time, it had a lot to do with, you know, my son being born and just being like, man, you know, I don't know what's going to happen, and I don't know what's going to happen with the bills. And you know, you just think like, kids, oh my god, kids are so expensive, and he's going to need this, and he's going to need insurance, and he's going to need all this crap, you know. But the reality, like what I realized once I was back at work, was that, you know, like work doesn't give you any security in a way, you know what I mean? It gives you a paycheck at the end of the week, and you can consider that security, but you know, it's like there's nothing sort of sheltering you from what can happen, you know what I mean? And I wasn't making enough, so it's like, even if I went back to work, I still wasn't making like enough money to really, you know, safeguard against like all that stuff I was really scared of happening with you know, having a kid, you know. So it wasn't, my fears weren't founded, but by the same token, I don't fault myself for being scared, because it's like, it is scary, you know, when you're having a little kid and you're like, I'm gonna have somebody else relying on me, and you know, like this person is like important, and I don't wanna fuck up, you know. But you know, after, like I said, you know, after a while of being there, you just realize it's like, you know, it's like, when you're an employee and you're working for somebody, you're like always the first one out the door, you know what I mean? When things hit, shit hits the fan, and the guy who owns the company is like the last one out the door. And I realize, like, no, it's like, I've got to be the last one out the door. I don't care about these people I work for. Like, I care about my kid, my family, so we get priority over, you know, whatever the hell they're doing. So I pretty much had to go back to work for myself. And it worked out. It's worked out so far, right? There's always a chance, you know, like every month, you know, is really like a scary kind of thing. I've just gotten used to it, but you know, you just, everything could dry up, you know, you don't know what could happen, but it's still, you know, in my opinion, better than depending on somebody who just does not care about you, like a boss, basically, in the sense that, like, they care about that you show up for work and make them money, you know, they don't care about it like you and your welfare, or your family's welfare and stuff. But that wasn't even, like, I got sidetracked there. I mean, I kind of wanted to just talk about, like, you know, like failure, because there was other times, like, in my past where I really didn't have, like, a set plan. And, like, a long time ago, I had this delivery job driving, like, a truck, and I ended up getting laid off from that job. And I was really sick of that job anyway. So there was a way I could have actually stayed there if I had really struggled to change things around. And I could have stayed, you know. But I thought, no, I'm gonna try art again. And this was kind of like after I had been in comics, you know, back in the 90s. And I was, you know, it was like right when I had first got on the web, you know what I mean? So I was on the web and I could see, like, there was a hell of a lot of potential there. But it's like, I didn't know, you know, like, how to make it work, you know? And so I was like, the hell with this, you know, I'm gonna go for it. And I had, like, a fair bit of savings at the time. And I, you know, was like, I can make it, you know, this many months. And that's what I did. I didn't quit. I was laid off, or whatever you want to say, but may as well have quit. And I tried art for a while, and I went back to, like, the way I had got into art the first time, which was, like, I'd go to a convention, and I'd show my stuff to editors, and you know, get jobs that way. And I went out to San Diego again, and you know, just everything had changed. You know, it was like vastly different than, like, when I had been there sort of in, you know, 96, 97, all that kind of stuff. And you know, this was around 2000, and this was probably like 2003 or something like that. It was just very, very different. And there just wasn't editors around, you know what I mean? Like, the whole system had been, you know, you'd go to a booth and there's just no editors, you know, and you kind of be looking around for, like, people who worked at Marvel, and, you know, and everybody I had worked for before, you know, this was, you know, like, the 90s was like the bust, so, like, everything went to hell. All the editors I knew and stuff were gone, so there was no sort of way back in that I could see without just kind of starting completely over and sending your samples out again and all that kind of stuff. And I tried that. I definitely tried that. Going out to the con didn't really do anything for me. And I just, you know, started sending my stuff out. I found, like, some, like, independent comic gigs online, you know. But, man, you know, it was just, like, back when I first was getting into comics, I worked for some people and they paid me like $8 a page. I remember that was like my first job ever. It was like I did this little miniseries thing in this comic, and they paid me $8 a page, and that was, you know, terrible money. It's like, why would you even do that? But, you know, especially like back then when there's no internet or nothing, you're just trying to get any kind of work anywhere that you could be seen and kind of prove yourself. And so that's what I did. Tanya's home. I can hear him coming in. I actually gotta go. I'm gonna put a part two on this because I've got to run out to my dad's today, and I gotta ship some stuff and all this kind of thing. And I've actually gotta go right now. So I'll see you guys later, or I'll see you guys tomorrow.